We take solar panels almost completely for granted nowadays, don't we? I mean, they're literally all over the place, aren't they? But as recently as 15 years or so ago, if I predicted that level of market adoption for what was then a prohibitively expensive and rather cumbersome technology, I'd have been laughed out of the room. Some market analysts actually were making those kind of predictions, most notably a visionary called Tony Sieber, who I'm sure you've heard of. And at the time, they were mostly being laughed out of rooms. Rooms that were populated predominantly by comfortable and rather complacent representatives of the fossil fuel industry, whose stranglehold over global energy markets at the time was absolute and unassailable. Things have changed a bit in the interim though, haven't they? And to paraphrase an old joke, they're not laughing now, are they? You'd be forgiven for thinking that technological advancements and cost reductions in solar photovoltaic technology are nearing the end of their journey by now. I mean, there's surely not much road left, is there, after a price drop of more than 90% in 10 years. But those in the know say the opposite may be true. They're suggesting we may be on the cusp of yet another steep market disruption S-curve. And one of the key reasons for that prediction is a little-known material called perovskite. So as part of our sustainable technology review series, I think it's time we dive back into the solar PV world to see what all the fuss is about in 2024. Hello and welcome to Just Ever Think. When I went back to re-watch my previous two videos on the subject of perovskites in solar photovoltaics as part of my preparation for this one, I realised I'd forgotten just how complex and mind-bending the science of capturing photons to make electricity really is. Rather than putting you good folks through the agony of yet another attempt at a fully animated and slightly long-winded explanation of the intricate detail, I've left links in the description section below to both of those videos, and instead, I'll just give you the TLDR summary. 1. Physics imposes a limit on how efficient a solar photovoltaic cell can become. It's all to do with which wavelengths of light physically interact with the receiving material in the cell. Materials that absorb a very wide range of wavelengths typically only deliver a very small voltage, and materials that produce a very high and therefore very useful voltage typically only capture a very small range of wavelengths, which means most of the energy in the sunlight is wasted. It's nature's way of having a bit of a laugh with us. 2. The trade-off between voltage and wavelength was established in 1961 by two physicists called William Shockley and Hans-Joachim Quasar, and it sets the maximum theoretical efficiency of a photovoltaic cell at about 30%, with silicon coming out as the ideal absorber. That's why the vast majority of solar PV cells today are based on silicon. 3. Perovskite is an inorganic compound that can be produced very precisely and inexpensively at low temperatures in laboratories. It can be chemically manipulated or tuned to capture different wavelengths of light to silicon, and it does a very nice job indeed of converting that light into electrical energy. It is far more tolerant of imperfections in the production process, and because of complicated reasons involving photons and phonons, which you can hear all about in my previous videos, it can be made much thinner than a silicon-based cell. A 1 micrometer thick piece of perovskite film can apparently convert almost as much light to electricity as a 200 micrometer wafer of silicon. 4. About 10 years ago, some clever science types realized that if you applied a thin layer of perovskite film on top of a wafer of silicon, you could absorb a far wider spectrum of light, maintain a good working voltage, and in theory, overcome that Shockley quasar limit of 30% efficiency. 5. In reality, perovskites have mostly been a bit of a letdown, really. They work beautifully on a lab bench, but as soon as you take them outside and expose them to things like moisture and heat and ultraviolet sunlight, they tend to degrade extremely quickly. It's nature's way of having a bit of a laugh with us. So the challenge of the last decade, in a nutshell, has been to eradicate the annoying deficiencies of perovskite and amplify the useful advantages. When we last checked on progress, it was a UK company called Oxford PV who looked like they'd come closest to that goal. In 2020, they were just starting to transition from years of laboratory experimentation to a full-sized commercial version of their silicon perovskite tandem cell. And I'm very pleased to say that at the time of making this video in early 2024, not only are they still going, which is more than can be said for many post-pandemic enterprises, but they've now built a new production line at an existing solar PV facility in Brandenburg an der Havel near Berlin in Germany, and they are well on their way to fully automated production of a market-ready panel with an efficiency of 28.6% and a proper outdoor working lifetime of somewhere between 25 and 30 years. Achieving that crucial commercially acceptable longevity is actually what's taken up the majority of the company's time and money over recent years. According to Chief Technology Officer Dr. Chris Case, the biggest challenge by far is durability and reliability. We already have great efficiency, much greater than current silicon cells, so most of our research and development is spent enhancing reliability. In January 2024, the company has just been featured in the Global Cleantech 100, which is an annual list of private companies most likely to make a significant market impact over the next 5 to 10 years. The Oxford PV team are not resting on their laurels though. They reckon a commercially affordable perovskite silicon tandem cell will soon break through the 30% Shockley quasar limit and achieve cost competitive efficiencies as high as 35% in the not too distant future. Which brings us neatly to a whole raft of other contenders that have also been making a lot of noise in the tech press recently. Never want to miss an investment opportunity, old Bill Gates has sunk a bit of cash into perovskites via his Breakthrough Energy Ventures project. He's backing a Massachusetts-based outfit called Cubic PV, who are an already well-established solar PV wafer manufacturer. They're developing a trademark technology called direct wafer manufacturing, which apparently eliminates several of the costly and energy-hungry steps in the production of light-absorbing wafers today, and instead creates high-performance versions of those wafers directly from a bath of molten silicon. They're now working to combine that with perovskite materials to create their own tandem modules, which they claim will offer at least a 30% increase in efficiency over the very best conventional silicon modules available on the market today. And in typically bullish free market style, they're telling the world that they've got the strongest patent portfolio in North America. In particular, they reckon they've really nailed the whole durability thing. Although the explanation on their website of precisely how they've achieved that elusive goal simply tells us that by using better chemistry, they have built intrinsic stability into the material itself, making it far more robust, which makes my earlier interpretation of TLDR look a bit like War and Peace, doesn't it? Anyway, the company's taking full advantage of the financial incentives offered by the US Inflation Reduction Act, and according to this 2023 article in PV Tech, it's also secured $103 million of private investment towards the construction of a brand new 10 gigawatt silicon wafer production facility that will also support the development of perovskite tandem cells. So definitely one to watch for the future, I'd say. Next up is a group based at the Helmholtz Center in Berlin, led by Professor Steve Albrecht. They recently published this paper explaining how a single layer of organic molecules can be used as an extremely efficient additional layer to collect charges excited by sunlight in the inorganic perovskite layer below. I've linked the paper in the description section of this video, so if you enjoy the challenge of making sense of complicated scientific language, then, you know, have fun. The layperson's summary is that Albrecht's team have achieved efficiencies of up to 32.5% in a silicon perovskite tandem cell that retained 95% of its initial power after 300 hours of operation. Their research forms part of a wider project called Pepperoni, funded by the European Union and the Swiss federal agency CERI. The project includes 16 other partners with the ultimate aim of building a European pilot line for these ultra-high efficiency perovskite silicon cells. Another European group, led by Dr. Xin-Yu Qin at the Federal Institute of Technology in Lausanne, Switzerland, published their research in 2023, explaining how they'd been able to modify two different phosphonic acids to improve the crystallization of the perovskite itself, all of which has apparently resulted in an overall cell efficiency of 31.25%, albeit from a laboratory cell sample that was only 1 centimeter square in size, and with a real-world survival time of only about 66 hours. Now, we couldn't do a video about solar PV without mentioning our friends over in the People's Republic of China, could we? Fun fact, according to recent analysis by Bloomberg Green, just in 2023 alone, China installed an eye-watering 217 gigawatts of additional solar capacity, exceeding the 175 gigawatts of solar capacity that the United States has installed in its entire history. So it should come as no great surprise that China's got teams of people beavering away on the Perovskite Challenge. One of those teams is based at the world's largest solar panel manufacturer, LONGi, based in Shanxi province. In November 2023, they claimed to have set a new world record of 33.9% efficiency for a silicon perovskite tandem cell, beating the previous record of 33.7% set in May 2023 by the King Abdullah University of Science and Technology in Saudi Arabia. These 30% plus claims are all very impressive and encouraging, of course, but there's a massive caveat with all of them, which is that they're all coming from those tiny little 1 centimeter square lab-based experimental cells. So until any of them come rolling off the end of a production line in a real factory with a manufacturer's 25-year warranty, it seems reasonable to suggest that Oxford PV is surely the most convincing of the current crop of competitors with a real-world product that you may well be able to buy for your house in the very near future. It's not hard to see why so much furious activity in perovskite research is going on though. As I said at the start of the video, solar PV is already the cheapest way to generate electricity in almost every country in the world now. There's really not much more that can be done to make the manufacture of the panels themselves any cheaper than they already are. So the only other way to keep that graph line falling is to improve the efficiency of power output from the same sized panel, which perovskites appear to be achieving. According to analysis by market consultants Precedence Research, the market for perovskites was worth just $94 million in 2022, but it's projected to explode up to something like $2.5 billion in the next 7 or 8 years or so, as more and more experimental research prototypes reach full-scale production readiness. So what do you think then? Will perovskites transform the market, or are they just another flash in the pan? If you've got news and views on the subject, then I'll be very interested to hear them. And as always, the place to leave them is in the comments section below here. That's it for this week though. A massive thank you to our Patreon supporters for providing feedback and essential corrections on the early access versions of all my videos, and for helping me keep them free of ads and sponsorship messages. If you'd like to get involved with that activity and influence the direction of the channel's content, then you can find out all about it at patreon.com/justeverthink. And if you don't want to miss out on notifications of new videos each week, then make sure you click on that subscribe button. It won't cost you a penny to do that, and it's just a simple click away, either down there somewhere or on that icon there. Most importantly, as always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.